Lahore.
All right, so here we are, one of the elephants.
It was a pretty sunset.
Back to Film Asterisk. We are getting to the end of the year. The leaves are gone. The snow is here sometimes. And there was a chill in the air. Brings me back to last year, honestly. Season 5 in the fall when I was watching every Fast and Furious movie and ripping my hair out trying to stay on top of everything. My senior film and my 5 other classes and my job and my radio show. Yeah, I'm recording live from my basement. The last time I've done a recording here, I believe, was for the Hulkback Mountain episode of Season 3 with Connor and Steve, but I'm happy to be back. It's just me and my cat napping on the couch. Anyways, not the point. But yeah, November, it is November time, and it got me reminiscing on concepts from the radio show that I kind of missed, particularly 2 of the solo episodes of Season 5. That I was probably most proud of, the stop-motion episode of Deep Picks and the Fast and Furious tier list, so I thought I could combine them with a personal movie marathon I did last week. I decided to take a day and just watch every Henry Selick film. Yes, Henry Selick of 2009's Coraline fame and many other lovely stop-motion classics. I never had seen any of them before, and I wanted to just experience his career as it is, straight through, one after another. And I was actually only going to watch his stop-motion films, his 4 main stop-motion films, but luckily for me, Connor and Steve saw what I was doing that day as I was rating films on Letterboxd, and they strong-armed me into watching 2001's Monkey Bone, which I will discuss here, but yeah, I did get through all 5 full-length feature films and even some shorts. But yeah, let's get into it. Welcome to an episode I have entitled Selick Fest, a uni-annual event where Dan was up from 6:30 a.m. to 11 p.m. the previous day, so he decides to take the next day off and just watch those 4 Henry Selick movies people keep talking about and getting tattoos of. Okay, Henry Selick was born in New Jersey in 1952. He was an avid animator from childhood, and when he grew up, he eventually made that his primary passion in life. He went to Syracuse University and shot his first film, 1975's Tube Tales, and eventually continued on to CalArts, where he made another short, 1979's Phases. Both of these are readily available on the YouTube, and they all, as you may expect, experimental animation shorts from the 1970s to be. Imagine Jim Henson's Timepiece, but, you know, the 70s. After graduating CalArts, he eventually got a job at Disney Animation Studios and became an in-betweener, which is a term, I guess, for an animator that is given the task of drawing the frames in between the frames. That is to say, the illusion of movement is created most effectively in animation when there are augmented or exaggerated frames in between the images we, the viewer's eyes, more pick up on. You can pause an animated movie and see this in action. Here is an example from The Fox and the Hound, a film I know Connor loves very much, so I used it as an example. While the principal animators are working on, like, the main frames of the film like this, guys like Henry Selick are in their stuffy office hunched over a drawing desk at 3 a.m. making images like this to help simulate motion in the film. So for many years, that was Selick's job, doing this, drawing these, and during the 1980s, he had some pretty cool credits. He was part of the animation department that worked on Pete's Dragon, The Fox and the Hound, so who knows, maybe these images really were drawn by him. The Black Cauldron, The Great Mouse Detective, and also Who Framed Roger Rabbit. He was also a storyboard artist for 1982's Tron and 1987's Brave Little Toaster. So very much just really working with pretty much all the big Disney animated films of the 1980s. He's somewhere on that animation team helping with these films. And during this time, he's able to make 2 short films of his own, 1981's Seepage and 1991's Slow Bob in the Lower Dimensions. But it wouldn't be until right after Slow Bob that Henry Selick would get a crack at his first full-length feature film, 1993's The Nightmare Before Christmas, a film largely attributed to its writer and producer, a guy named Tim Burton. So, Nightmare Before Christmas. After the success of Burton's Vincent in 1982, Disney started to consider developing Nightmare Before Christmas as either a short film or a 30-minute holiday television special. However, the project's development eventually stalled, as its tone seemed too weird for the company, which, fair, weird movie. As Disney was unable to offer his nocturnal loners enough scope, Burton was fired from the studio in 1984 and went on to direct the commercially successful film Beetlejuice and Batman. But he never forgot that film idea he had, and that old Disney buddy of his, Henry Selick, to which he'd shown concept art to back in 82. So a decade later, the film was greenlit, with Disney eager to actually now expand their image within their animation department. This also comes at the time where some of the most key animators from the beginning of the company in the 1920s and 1930s all finally retiring or just passing away. You can actually look them up. It's like the nine old men. That's kind of what they're called, of the Disney Animation Studio, that pretty much were the forebearers of all the animation we got in the 20th century. And just as the 80s is kind of coming in, it's an interesting new era. It's before the 90s renaissance, but it's after the major work of these guys. You see this kind of transition of old blood to new blood. And Henry Selick and Tim Burton, all two of the most prolific students of being able to work in the final years with these original nine old men, which kind of shows, like, I mean, when I'm talking about Tim Burton and Henry Selick, there's this feeling of this amazing tradition of animation that they were able to learn and glean so much from a lot of these amazing mid-century animators and kind of update that for the modern day. And we get some really cool examples of that. So Tim Burton couldn't direct because of his commitment to Batman Returns, and he also did not want to be involved with the painstakingly slow process of stop motion. And luckily for us, Selick was all on board and delivered an insane piece of stop motion mastery that, well, it's literally become like one of the most iconic pieces of Halloween media we've been given in the last 30 years. I mean, 30th anniversary coming up on this thing, which is crazy, and it still hits. It still hits 30 years later. I mean, just look at all the Jack Skellington faces everywhere, just slapped on everything. They're all over the place. I mean, I gotta say, the production design, I think a lot of the production design is pretty inspired by older European film movements of the silent era, cough, cough, Der Golem, except it's taken to a whole new level here. I mean, the uniquity of the character design, the dark humor and dramatics of the story, the pacing of the film, the music from Danny Elfman, God, it just makes for a really exciting watch that feels much longer than its 76-minute runtime. This thing is just an hour and change, but it feels like it's a really fully fleshed story. Now, you may not consider this a positive like I do, but I never grew up watching any Tim Burton content. I mean, the only film I saw was of his was Charlie and the Chocolate Factory, and that was once in movie theaters when it came out, and I didn't even remember anything about it until I rewatched it like last year. But being able to come into a film like Nightmare Before Christmas with really no previous knowledge of Burton or Selick or what they do or how their films feel, and kind of trying to analyze this thing down to the bare bones, it really is just a crazy triumph of stop motion. I certainly have my issues with it. You know, it's not my favorite film of all time. But you know, I think the Jack Skellington songs are the only ones that I really connect with. Oogie Boogie kind of doesn't make sense as an antagonist. Sometimes it's a bit too much visual noise in any one given shot, but these are pretty minor complaints when considering the entirety of the film. I just really like this thing. Henry Selick's directing in particular establishes a visual language as well that's just kind of groundbreaking. I mean, the long sweeping shots sometimes with these crazy slanted angles, extreme close-ups, moving living environments around the characters, it's beautifully grotesque. I suppose that's the point. But I understand the hype, the appreciation now that I've seen it. It's kind of weird, but overall, just a fun time. So I put it in the X tier for exquisite. X marks the spot. Yeah, good movie. I have a friend who was flabbergasted that I'd never seen this movie before, and I'm sure she'll be happy and jumping up and down that I also like this movie now. Shout out to Maddie in Maryland. But next up, 1996's James and the Giant Peach. Now, Selleck was still under Disney at this time, and a James and the Giant Peach film was bounced around the Disney animation offices a lot in the 1980s, during Selleck's main tenure as an animator. Now, Walt Disney acquired the film rights to the book from the Roald Dahl estate in 1992, and Dennis Potter, a British playwright, was actually hired to write a draft. And it was described as a slightly black and bizarre script, and it was a tone Disney did not approve of, particularly a bit where the Schalks in the film were Nazis, like, directly. And here's the crazy thing. Dennis Potter died in 1994, and Disney waited until he died and then switched directions, asking Kerry Kirkpatrick and Bruce Joel Rubin to come in and write separate drafts, of which Kirkpatrick's was chosen. And it's insane that they waited for this poor man to die, I guess to avoid a difficult conversation. Disney, but whatever. Before the start of production, Disney and Selleck debated on whether the film should be live action or stop motion animated. The company's skeptical of the stop motion solution. Selleck had originally planned James to be a live actor through the entire film, then later considered doing the whole film in stop motion, but ultimately settled on entirely live action and entirely stop motion sequences with some digital VFX to keep lower costs. And that is one of the most interesting parts of the film, these segmented portions that have a clear beginning, middle, and end. The harsh live-action reality, contrasted with the dreamlike stop-motion adventure, and the finale, which works to meld both realities. And I do love what that says about how the beauty of fiction can fuel the harsh truths of real life, and vice versa. So it's pretty, like, obvious. The beginning, like, 20 minutes are live-action. It's James living a terrible life now that his parents are gone. This poor, this semi-orphan boy with his aunts. And then he goes into the peach and it's stop motion. And then when he leaves the peach, that's the end of the film. That's how it goes. So the aforementioned script of the film itself does kind of have like a 90s bent to it. You can kind of feel that the horrid aunts of James and James himself are kind of written, framed, acted, very similar to the lighthearted children's films of the time, like Home Alone, Hocus Pocus, Matilda. And this film in particular doesn't age great for that reason, but it's certainly a unique chapter in Selleck's career, which I appreciate. And once again, Rotten Tomatoes consensus really hits the nail on the head with this one, actually, describing it as the arresting and dynamic visuals, offbeat details, and light-as-air storytelling makes James and the Giant Peach solid family entertainment. So, despite it being easier on the subconscious than Nightmare Before Christmas, it is arguably, I think, just a bit less charming and long-standing as Selleck's previous effort, despite, I think, it just having some really nice roots in a Roald Dahl adaptation, which honestly does the film wonders. So, I give James and the Giant Peach a V tier. Very average, but like a strong V. Hefty V. All right, next up, Henry Selleck enters the new millennium with a bold new style and star-studded cast in 2001's Monkey Bone, originally based on the underground comic series Darktown. A copy of Darktown was actually given to Selleck's producer by a member of the San Francisco animation community, and Selleck fell in love with the sensibilities of the comic and pursued the rights to develop it. Monkey Bone sees Selleck making a primarily live-action film with some stop-motion and a good chunk of digital VFX creating the otherworldly moments of the film. Definitely well done, thanks to it in the hands of a talent like Selleck, but still, 2001 VFX that still don't age great. In Monkey Bone, Stuart Stu Miley is a disillusioned cartoonist whose comic character, a rascal monkey named Monkey Bone, is seeing a lot of success and now getting an animated series. And that night when, like, the announcement of the animated series and all the merchandise and all this is going on in LA, he plans on proposing to his girlfriend, Julie McElroy, who is a sleep institute worker who helped him deal with his nightmares by changing his drawing hand. But one night, Stu falls into a coma following a car crash before he can propose to her. His spirit is taken to Downtown, a surreal and carnival-themed limbo-like landscape populated by mythical beings and figments of its visitors' imaginations, Monkey Bone included. He gets to meet his own creation down there. Now, initially, the role of Stuart Miley was to be played by Ben Stiller, but Stiller dropped out to be in Mystery Man and was replaced by Brendan Fraser. And here, this is a snippet from my Letterboxd review, pretty much word for word, because Steve demanded my thoughts on the film after I watched it. I was kind of the litmus test, so Connor and Steve can know what I thought about this movie. Very much the canary in the coal mine, but it doesn't matter. I think it's a little bit of a meme that my generation misses Brendan Fraser so much, and there's a whole movement to revive his career, but I think it comes from a good place, because the kids my age miss their fun, silly goof boy from their childhood in the late 90s, early 2000s, but Brendan Fraser is a national treasure. Dude is just charming and a good actor, and I'm on board with this, and seeing such kind of an offbeat early example of his acting in general, I think it deserves a lot of praise, despite him always just kind of picking more family-friendly, more goofy roles. I still think that him as a serious actor, as a talented actor, hopefully is not lost on the audience. It probably isn't now in retrospect, but back then it might have been. So Monkey Bone, as a film for Selleck, seems very self-reflective, despite it being most out of his regular styles of filmmaking that he's become known for. I mean, I can appreciate it for that. He plays with the idea of animators becoming their creations and societal perspectives on artists. I mean, Selleck's solution to what happens to you when you're in a coma is apparently a horrifying carnivalscape that is full of creativity, and it's pretty cool, honestly. And damn it, the script is really good, too. Like, it's unique, it's clever, so many fun things. Just one random example, I do love how the whole tie-ins with sleep and nightmares and comas and death and stuff. I mean, the idea that Stu, a cartoonist, met his girlfriend at a sleep clinic she worked at, and Monkey Bone was created from switching from his right hand to his left when drawing, going from making gruesome nightmares to lighthearted mature comics. Plus, the characters are fully fleshed out, they're intriguing, distinct. Why the hell is this movie good? The little digital effects that are utilized are kind of annoying and dated. It's 2001 after all, but this film's like Baz Luhrmann levels of hyper-stylized insanity. I mean, the whole film really can be described as Who Framed Roger Rabbit meets Cool World. It really can. And consider the fact that, I mean, Selleck worked on Who Framed Roger Rabbit. Like, this is in the camp, you know? This is in the Disney animation camp. So everything that I just said about the film and how I felt about it, that pretty much goes for the first 40 minutes of the film. Everything after, the second half, I can take or leave, and probably more leave than take. It kind of blows, but that's when all the awesome cameos are, so you kind of need to stick around for it. $79 million budget, $7 million box office, so there's a reason none of us know about this thing. It is an absolute box office critical bomb. But hey, if you're going to watch it, prepare yourself for an insane trip. But yeah, I mean, the first 40 minutes for me are just, they're really fantastic, exciting, perfectly executed. But once you hit that midway point, it just dips super hard. Like, so with the lopsided nature of the film in mind, I give Monkey Bone a V, very average. Selleck's third film, one half amazing, one half meh. And I guess last point, Chris Kattan is in this movie, and in this film, might be him at his funniest for me, so that was really cool. Moving on. Next up for Selleck was maybe one of his most unique credits, because in between films, he actually links up with auteur-director Wes Anderson and helps to create the underwater VFX and creatures in his film The Life Aquatic. Arguably, some of the best bits of that film are indeed the Selleck contributions, and I mention this only because, yes, it's a little fun fact, but this collaboration comes into play later on, but more on that very soon. Next up is actually a short film Henry Selleck directed. It's a fully digital animation short, 2005's Moon Girl. During my, like, 10-hour, 9-hour movie marathon, I use this as a bit of a, like, palate cleanser, something short and easy and cute to watch, just about at the halfway point, and that is exactly what it is. The plot being, Leon is night fishing on the bayou when the light of the moon dims and a massive catfish transports him onto a theme park ride to the moon, where he teams up with a moon girl and her giant cat. The mission? To reignite the moon and help defend her from a pair of rascally goggle-hoons. It's right here, though, that I realized the trend that I was seeing with the Selleck films. We had a fully film-shot, stop-motion film with Nightmare, and then a mostly stop-motion with live-action scenes and a few digital VFX with Giant Peach. Then Monkey Bone was mostly live-action with some stop-motion that leaned heavily on digital VFX. And now we have Selleck's first kind of personal project short film in over a decade, no inhibitions or expectations, and it's fully digital. And it looks more like a test short that works as like a proof of concept or pitch rather than an honest-to-God like short film. So it's been a minute since we got something close to the aesthetics and practices that made Nightmare such an iconic film to begin with, and at this point, with the box office bomb that was Monkey Bone, it's hard to see Selleck's directing career advance beyond this, but in fact, this is exactly right when things kind of turned Escortus into what I would say is the second part of Selleck's career. So, moving on from this, there is not much to say on Moon Girl. It's nice. The animation doesn't fully hold up, but I do appreciate the story. I think there is something there to it. It's very cute. I give it a V for very average, and also, I wanted to mention in all his credits and films, this one, Moon Girl, is the only one out of anything ever Selleck has an acting credit, as he is the voice of the rascally goggle-hoons. So I thought that was pretty cool. But yeah, it is at this point where I think things could have gone very differently for Henry Selleck in his career if it wasn't for a few really interesting opportunities. It is at this point, around 2005, that Selleck signed on as animation director for Wes Anderson's Fantastic Mr. Fox. But in February of 2006, Henry Selleck left the project to work on a new film and be the CCO of a brand new unknown stop-motion studio based out of Portland, Oregon, the same studio that he had made Moon Girl with. And I am, of course, referring to Leica Entertainment and the studio's debut film directed by Henry Selleck, 2009's Coraline.
Oh, I'm not supposed to talk about it. I'm Wybie. Wybie Lovett.
Wybie?
Short for Wyborn. Not my idea, of course. What'd you get saddled with?
I wasn't saddled with anything. It's Coraline.
Caroline what?
Coraline. Coraline Jones.
It's not real scientific, but I heard an ordinary name, like Caroline, can lead people to have ordinary expectations about a person.
I think I heard someone calling you Wyborn.
What? I didn't hear anything.
Oh, I definitely heard someone. Why were you born?
Grandma. Well, great to meet a Michigan water witch. But I'd wear gloves next time.
Why?
Because that dowsing rod of yours, it's poison oak.
Coraline Jones moves to an old house in Ashland, Oregon. She feels bored and neglected by her parents, but when she finds a hidden door, which houses a parallel world, where everybody has buttons instead of eyes, she discovers more caring versions of her parents. When Coraline's other mother invites her to stay in her world forever, more nefarious truths surface about her newfound reality. Based on the novel by Neil Gaiman, Coraline stands as not only the first stop-motion film under Leica's belt, but also the first stereoscopic stop-motion animated film ever. Essentially a 3D stop-motion film. That's what that means. My thoughts are probably closest to that of, I found this, A.O. Scott of the New York Times, who called the film exquisitely realized with a slower pace and a more contemplative tone than the novel. It is certainly exciting, but rather than race through even noisier set pieces towards a hectic climax in the manner of so many animation films that are aimed at kids, Coraline lingers in an atmosphere that is creepy, wonderfully strange, and full of feeling. And I think that pacing and examination of set pieces with Selleck's direction, yeah, this film has a much longer lasting watch for people of really any age. It's pretty amazing how it captures the texture of Nightmare Before Christmas, but updated kind of for a 21st century audience with HD expectations. I mean, it's certainly complex and crafted to be immersive as a film, but you can really feel like you're on set with the characters, the film crew, except wait, no, you're not. It's like a miniature set. So the whole thing is bringing together just some awesome and unexpected voice talents as well. Dakota Fanning with her thick Midwest Michigan accent, Terry Hatchett and John Hodgman as Coraline's parents, Keith David as the cat, awesome. Robert Bailey Jr. is YB as well, a weird, striking sidekick of sorts along Coraline's adventures. Henry Selick's kids, George and Harry, also have cameos in the film as like a ghost child and one of Coraline's old friends from Michigan. So, super fun. This is the other film of Selick's that I like really heard about growing up because I knew kids whose parents took them to it and it kind of messed them up and creeped them out, and people my age still have an apprehension towards this film. And I do not blame them. This thing is freaky. And yeah, oriented towards kids, but like, damn, maybe take your foot off the gas a bit. I mean, you have your main character confronted by ghost children and fake parents trying to pop her eyeballs out with needles. And okay, that's a bit of a spoiler, but also it isn't, because it's literally what happens in the opening credits scene of the film. So that's not a spoiler, but whatever. I only mean to say that this thing is indeed some true nightmare fuel. But for someone watching it now, at my age, I can't help but just, I guess, marvel at its execution. So yeah, I gotta give Coraline the old Y tier. Yabba dabba do. Yeah, this is indeed my favorite Henry Selick film. But it is as well a great achievement in stop motion animation. And if the film has any flaws, well yeah, it does have some, but I'm gonna mention one. It's that the film doesn't really want to make me watch another Henry Selick film. It makes me want to watch another Laika film. I think Laika is the stronger of the two parties involved, but Coraline does not exist with just one or the other. You need both, and thank goodness this collaboration came together. And yeah, I'd be excited to see Laika and Henry Selick come back together to make another movie. I think it would be awesome. I mean, there have always been rumors of Coraline 2 for forever at this point, I think. I would argue I'm not always down for a sequel to a one-off unique film or series like this. I mean, for a couple reasons. For me, I mean, if the original creators aren't all coming back, if the production value has changed drastically, it's just kind of not worth it, because the consistency from the base of just how the product literally looks and is put together, it doesn't really work for me. I mean, look at Community Season 6, things that just don't feel canonically in the universe of the original because they're just made differently. But if Henry Selick directed Coraline 2 with Laika, which is most likely to be the case if it ever exists, if it happens at all, I would be 1000% down for that, because to be honest, once the film finished, I kind of just sat there and being like, this thing really could have a sequel. I mean, a sequel would work in this universe. There are still unanswered questions. Though I wouldn't want like a, oh, now Coraline's an adult and she's a bad mom and her daughter is in the other world and she has to become a better mother to be, I don't know. I want Dakota Fanning as a teenager exploring the world some more with YB as Coraline or something. I don't know, just something that stays close to the period of the film itself, not a giant time jump. But hey, we're getting off task here. This isn't Dan pitches Coraline 2. This is the Selick Fest, so let's continue his story. After the pretty remarkable success of Coraline becoming the third highest grossing stop motion film of all time, Selick actually left Laika in 2009 and in 2010 joined with Pixar and the Walt Disney Company in a long-term contract to exclusively produce stop motion films. This not only returned Selick to his original roots, but also reunited him with numerous former friends and co-animators. And he started a new studio called Cinderbiter Productions, which was self-described as a new stop-motion company whose mandate is to make great, scary films for youngins with a small, tight-knit crew who watch each other's backs. So things are kind of turning around. This is a great reunion of Disney and Selick, and new movies are kind of in the works, and it's 2011, and it's 2012, and it's 2013, and where is Henry Selick's new film with Pixar and Disney? Well, it never came. Selleck and Cinderbiter's first film under this deal, a project called Shademaker, was set to be released on October 4th, 2013. In 2011, the film was greenlit for production and retitled The Shadow King, and in August of 2012, it was reported that after spending a reported $50 million, Walt Disney Pictures canceled the project due to a creative and scheduling standpoint, the picture wasn't where it needed to be to meet its planned release date. Selleck now had the option to shop the project to another studio. Selleck later revealed that in interviews, the film suffered from interference from the CCO of Pixar, John Lasseter, who Selleck claimed came in and constantly changed elements of the script and production that ended up ballooning the project, which is not surprising that John Lasseter pulled some stuff like that. It's too bad that we didn't get this film at all. This would have been interesting, you know? So it's a shame that we didn't get a 2010s film from Henry Selleck due to that reason. The future of the film is still pretty up in the air. No one really knows what the plan is, but in August of 2016, a rep for Selleck said the film is in turnaround again, and Selleck continued to work on another project, a little film called Wendell and Wilde. And here's something I didn't mention way back in the beginning, when we were still discussing Selleck's college career, and namely his first film, Tube Tales. One of the final spoofing ads in this short film, it's a short film about just like spoofing commercialist television ads, capitalist television ads in the 70s. It's an ad for a crowd plow. Here's the clip.
Isn't it about time for a crowd plow? The Wendell Wilde crowd plow. Cut through crowds both large and small.
Boy, I like TV.
Yeah, this is great.
Did you hear anything there? A familiar name? And to me, it seems that Wendell and Wilde is actually, in its infancy, a name that references the Wendell Wilde crowd plow from Selleck's first film ever. Though that was, I thought that was just a little fun fact to put in there. And this is also, this film, Wendell and Wilde, is a return to some of the character styles Selleck developed during Slow Bob in the Lower Dimensions as well in 91, way back before Nightmare. So he's pulling from his entire history of stop motion here to create this one. But yeah, Wendell and Wilde, plot. Two demon brothers enlist the aid of Cat Elliot, a tough teen with a load of guilt, to summon them to the land of the living, but what Cat demands in return leads to a brilliantly bizarre and comedic adventure like no other. As I said in my final review for Selleck Fest, come for the final missing piece of Key & Peele media, stay for the death needle drops. This film is pretty interesting as a historical time capsule of sorts, because this is in many ways the last good, like, Key & Peele media that was kind of made, and also the first film under the Monkey Paw banner, as the vocal recordings began just as Key & Peele, the comedy sketch show, was ending. Of course, Keegan-Michael Key and Jordan Peele had their film Keanu in 2016, which is kind of like another last hurrah, but right after filming that, they began to work on this film with Henry Selleck, and during the long animation process, we would get three films of modest renown from Jordan Peele: Get Out, Us, Nope, under his Monkey Paw Productions, and Keegan-Michael Key would go on to be a voice in some of the most successful animated movies of the past couple years. You got Lego Movie, Hotel Transylvania franchise, and like Toy Story 4, also with Jordan Peele. So yeah, this is in many ways the last bit of Key & Peele media we got, still technically during their main run as a duo, before their careers just kind of went their separate ways, and that is really special. Overall, I'd say every performance in the film is pretty on point. I love Lyric Ross as the vocal lead. Angela Bassett kind of kills it too, and them being the two Hell Maidens with a sort of mentor-apprentice relationship, but kind of taking that stereotypical character relationship and very much turning it on its head. And that is maybe the most admirable aspect of the film, the fact that almost every character has a basis in a stereotypical character that we've seen before, and then the film does its best to give that character a brand new spin. And it also, during that time, tries to create this universe the film exists in and tell Kat's story all at the same time. I think it does one a bit better than the other, because a lot of the world building that I'd kind of want from this film kind of gets lost or just rushed along. We don't really learn either in visual language or backstory too much about the prep school or the town itself or the underworld, what it means to be a Hell Maiden, the backstory of Sister Helly or Janitor Manberg. Like, only enough to understand basically what's happening, and the story just kind of happens over that. And the thing is, this thing has the love and care it deserves with characters and production design, but the straightforward at times story and world building kind of tends to falter. And yeah, it kind of loses steam a little bit throughout, but this thing gets easily a W for worth a watch, and also Wendell and Wild, W tier. And yeah, that's about it. Henry Selick's expansive career, tiered up and analyzed. As is with any stop motion artist, it's hard to keep the craft going, considering how time consuming it is, but the examples we have of those who have found a place to share their artistic voice have been pretty awesome, and Henry Selick is one of many. And so concludes SelickFest, a uni-annual event where Dan was up from 6:30 a.m. to 11 p.m. the previous day, so he decides to take the next day off and just watch those four Henry Selick movies people keep talking about and getting tattoos of. Thank you for listening. As always, you can check out my reviews of every Henry Selick film on Letterboxd at DA_N, as well as the film and list from season 5 and 6. And if you want to see other films discussed on Film And, you can go to Connor's Letterboxd list at Cranberry18, C-R-A-N-D-Berry 18. That is all we have for today. For the rest of the year, we got a few more concepts I'd love to get to if I have time. We'll see. And obviously the Andes are slowly approaching, which I'm very excited for. But yeah, other than that, you will hear from me later. Until then, stay warm and have a good rest of your week.